please remain standing as we sing together hymn number 521, On Jordan's Stormy Banks I Stand, which was Doug's favorite hymn. You'll find the hymnal in the pew rack in front of you. Again, it's page number 521, and we'll sing all four stanzas.
Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life, and he who believes in me will live even if he dies, and everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Those words give us hope today, hope for Marilyn and Clista and Tracy and Mary Evelyn, for Glen and Mike and James, and for all the family and friends of Doug Whitehurst. This afternoon is a time for us to hurt together over the loss of this friend, but it's also a time for us to celebrate a life well lived and to rejoice in the fact that he has gone ahead of us to be with our Lord. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for Doug and for his life and for his legacy, and we recognize that the time that you gave of him to be with each person here, that is a precious gift from you. And Father, we gather in the hope of Doug's resurrection and that he is complete and fulfilled and whole. And we praise you for that, and we thank you for that hope. And Lord, I pray that all of his family and friends would feel your hope today. In your name we pray, amen. The family is so thankful that Margaret Williams-Jones could be here today, a longtime friend of the family. You may know they've moved to Dallas, so thank you for coming today. And then Katie Beth and Clista, Doug's granddaughter and daughter, will be sharing with us today.
I am Katie Beth Ongina, and Doug Whitehurst was my gramps. I'm Clista and Glenn's youngest daughter, and I have the honor to represent the grandchildren as we celebrate Gramps' life today. To open, I'd like to read a few verses from the fifth chapter of Galatians. This is where Paul writes about the fruits of the Spirit, which Gramps embodied in his life. Galatians 5, 22-24 says, "By contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also be guided by the Spirit. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. In 2006, along with many of my family who are here today, I attended my Aunt Mary Evelyn's law school graduation. We come from a long line of very supportive family members who show up for one another, and on this day, we were all gathered to celebrate Emmy. During the ceremony, I had the benefit of sitting next to Gramps. At one point, I looked over at Gramps, and it looked like he was taking notes during the law school graduation. But then I saw he was just writing down a lot of numbers. I asked him about it, and he explained that he was doing base 16 math, which is called hexadecimal. If that doesn't make sense to you, you are the majority in this room. Throughout the rest of the ceremony, Gramps taught me hexadecimal. And throughout the day, he continued to call out math problems, challenging me to put my new knowledge to work. I tell you this particular story because it sums up so many wonderful things about Gramps. He was relentlessly proud of his family. He was pretty much always the smartest person in the room, or the Colosseum in this particular example. He made you feel great about yourself. He believed everyone had the ability to learn, and he loved to learn and to teach. In honor of Gramps and Base 16 Math, I want to share 16 characteristics and memories with you about Gramps. Don't let 16 scare you. This will not be very long. I promise to be brief. But let's be honest, binary code just didn't give enough opportunities to say great things about him. You will see how these 16 characteristics and memories align with the fruits of the Spirit, showing how Gramps lived out his faith in his life. I will be following the base 16 structure in his honor, which starts with zero and ends with the letter F. Let's begin. Zero. Gramps was one of the most welcoming people I've ever known. This was especially true at an airport. You would arrive at the airport in Albuquerque, and he would pull up to the curb sporting a huge smile, and he would get out and give you one of his giant embraces. His hugs made you feel loved, safe, and cared for. I know I'm not the only one who experienced this, so probably mainly this area, but maybe out here. Raise your hand if you ever got picked up at the airport from Gramps and experienced this. Yes, most welcoming person. Number one, Gramps was incredibly generous. He was generous with his love, with his time, with his attention, and more practically speaking, with expenses to come visit. Even after Gramps and Mame would cover the cost of your flight to Santa Fe, he would make sure you left with gas money. I would say, but I didn't drive here. And he would insist that you still needed to leave with a little gas money. Gramps found joy in taking care of the people that he loved. Number two, Gramps was fun and funny. Gramps and Mame created an oasis of fun. During a visit, they would offer you a feed up or a little lie down, but they would never partake themselves. Gramps was always up to something. Looking for snakes out by the lake, driving four-wheelers, throwing bumpers for the dogs to fetch, working in his workshop, or meeting his friends at Tiny's or Vinaigrette in Santa Fe. He was also always ready to tell you a funny story about Boudreaux. His jokes never got old, even if there was a repeat on occasion. Number three, Gramps was presentable. This may sound funny, but 100% of the time, Gramps was presentable and put together. He would walk out of his room first thing in the morning, I'd still be in my pajamas drinking coffee, and he would be fully dressed, tucked in, ready to start the day, and not a hair out of place. I will always picture Gramps in a button-down collared shirt, jeans, belt, and cowboy boots. Speaking of cowboy boots, this takes us to memory number 4. Today, you will see that many of the grandchildren are wearing our cowboy boots. This is in honor of Gramps, because he found true joy out of getting all of his grandchildren cowboy boots over the years. This aligns with the generosity I mentioned earlier. He loved spoiling the people that he loved. In fact, he bought me and my husband both the cowboy boots that we wore to our wedding reception. Number 5, Gramps loved baseball, which I'm sure everyone in here knows. And he wanted to share his love of baseball with his grandkids. So on multiple occasions, became an annual trip, he flew all of his grandkids out to Phoenix to attend spring training. It wasn't until I was preparing for this and really reflecting on it that I don't know of a lot of grandfathers who would go solo with all of the grandkids to Phoenix, and I just think it's pretty remarkable. We would go to multiple baseball games, seeing different teams play at various stadiums. He insisted that the correct way to watch a baseball game was with a hot dog and a beer. Sometimes he would bend the rules for those of us who preferred wine. In between games, we went to fun dinners, hung out at the hotel happy hour, and ventured out to see the Grand Canyon. I know I speak for all of my cousins when I say we will cherish these memories forever. Number 6 is hunting trips to South Dakota. Gramps loved to hunt, and he took the opportunity to share this love with his friends, sons-in-laws, grandsons, and even his granddaughter's husbands. Gramps sponsored an annual trip for this group of men to travel to South Dakota to go pheasant hunting in the fall. And I know from everyone who has gone that the experience hunting was almost as fun as the meaningful time spent with Gramps. Number 7, Gramps was an artist. Not only did he engineer rockets, but he created some of the most beautiful pieces of art, which are typically also functional. Almost everyone in the family has a chandelier that he hand welded and a wooden cooler that he designed and crafted by hand. One thing I personally loved is that I spent the first year of the pandemic working from home on a desk that he had made for my mom when she was 12. Gramps was an artist, and I love that we all have his pieces in our homes to remember him by. Number 8 is dancing. Gramps was always up for a party and a good time. You could always count on him to rock the dance floor at every wedding. In fact, he even cut in on the father-daughter dance at my wedding. He was an amazing dancer, and I recall many celebrations when it seemed like Gramps almost needed a dance card to sign because we all wanted to take a turn with him. Number 9. I mentioned Gramps' generosity earlier, but it goes well beyond love, attention, cowboy boots, and trips. Gramps was generous with his knowledge and his stories. Gramps never forced his wisdom on you, but we all craved hearing more. He was generous sharing his stories and teaching us. And he had an uncanny humility, so much so that it's often hard to wrap your mind around just how brilliant he was. You don't think about someone so brilliant being so approachable. I'll now pivot to a few memories and reflections from my cousins, just as hexadecimal transfers from numbers to letters. A. My cousin Douglas shared this. Gramps had a unique manner of making you feel not only warm and welcome, but important. When you were with him, you were important. He heard you. He listened and valued you and your time. He made time for anyone and everyone. His kindness and warmth to everything and everyone is something I and everyone should strive for. From my husband, Josh. Gramps is a man who lived his life to the fullest. I loved Gramps dearly. He treated me as his own grandson. Between the ski trips to Santa Fe and hunting in South Dakota, I am so grateful for the memories created. I would never miss an early morning coffee or breakfast just to be sure I could download all of the stories and wisdom he passed along. Those are my favorite times with him. The impact he made on our family and others will last forever. C, from Michael. To the grandchildren and great-grandchildren, he was Gramps. But more than that, he was the most kind, loving, well-mannered gentleman I could have ever asked for in a grandfather. From the hunting trips, baseball trips, time at the lake, working in the shop, learning to weld, field trips, trips to Santa Fe, the list goes on. Field trials. He wasn't one to know a little about a lot. He knew a lot about everything and was always eager to teach. So much so that at times when he explained designing the first navigational rocket, I would just nod as if I understood, when in reality, he had lost me from the start. The stories, time spent together, and laughs we shared until the very end, I will cherish forever. From my sister Mary, D. The fact that he was finding errors in his school tests and writing to the test makers as a little kid might have predicted that he would become a rocket scientist. He was the only person I'd fly across the country to go to baseball games with. I usually read plays during the games, but he didn't mind. He still bought me hats and hot dogs. Gramps, somewhere you are teaching somebody binary code over a beer. You didn't just make your mark on the world and those of us who loved you. You reached beyond it to the stars, and now you are among them where I imagine you're right at home. E, and from me. One thing I know I will miss is hearing Gramps say, "Hey, darling." If you heard him say this, you know what I'm talking about. Gramps would say, "Hey, darling," and you knew you were loved, cared for, admired, and appreciated. Gramps could be present and in the moment more than just about anyone I know. You were never second to anything when you were with him. May we all aspire to be as present and loving as he showed us was possible. And F, I'd like to share a reflection from his obituary. As a father, he imparted to his daughters the principles that would anchor his life. Your word is your bond. Integrity and character cannot be compromised. God can do anything. Prayer is essential. There is no problem that does not have a solution. Every job deserves the very best you can give. Gramps, you left a legacy of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, and a desire to know and follow God. Thank you for loving all of us for who we are and teaching us how to be present and in the moment, while always striving to be our best. We hope you're enjoying a hot dog and a beer, while playing with your dogs and watching a great baseball game and possibly teaching someone else hexadecimal.
Consider all. Amen, Margaret. Is it any wonder that Daddy adored Margaret since she was a teenager? She was one of his girls. So thank you. I'm not sure I can talk after that. Psalm 103:13 says, "As a father is kind to his children, so the Lord is kind to his people." And Luke 15:20 at the end of the prodigal son says, "And the boy got up and started back to his father, and he was still a long way off when his father saw him and was filled with compassion and ran to his son and threw his arms around him and kissed him." It was never hard for me and for my sisters to picture God as a father because Dad was our dad. That's the essence of it. Even our last words to him were, "I love you, Dad. Thanks for being our dad. You were the best." Dad took care of us, the three of us, Tracy, Mary Evelyn, and me, all of our lives, and he tried to take care of us and Marilyn even when we were taking care of him. Dad, we realize now, was a rare and wonderful man because he lived his life in total faith in God, and he modeled that for the three of us. He made it easy to see God as a father because we had a living witness, a dad, in our home. No, he wasn't perfect, but he was perfectly dad. One professor called him an enigma, and Dad was certainly that, because he was brilliant and exacting and productive and creative and impatient and interesting and had high expectations. And as Tracy said, he didn't suffer fools gladly. But Dad was also full of love and mercy and patience and kindness and goodness and all those things that Katie Beth just said. He appreciated people around him and the world around him. And with him as our dad, it just wasn't a big leap to understand God as a father. Dad grew up in places that didn't have names, on the outskirts of Converse and Mansfield. Most of those places are now under Toledo Bend. And they were always down a dirt road and near an oil rig. He and his older brother Charles, and I don't know how much Bob had to do with this, but they worked on the oil rigs with our papaw and even drove big semi-trucks with the rigs on the back. Dad had a vivid memory of being 14 and driving a big 18-wheel truck with the rig on the back, and my Uncle Pete told him that he had to drive that truck over a bridge across the Mississippi River. And Dad said, "I can't do it." And Uncle Pete said, "You have to do it." And Dad said, "I'm not doing it," and made Uncle Pete change places with him. He got better as he got older, but he said at 14, he just about wasn't ready for that. As a child, Dad loved learning. And one thing I shared with Dad was the love for books. Even at 90, he would have told you about the thrill of learning that a library would allow him to take a book home and read it. And his books were his friends. Long after he could really read, he liked to count his books. He knew what was in those books. Those books were his friends, and I feel the same way about mine. Daddy never really quit going to school. He even went to classes out there in Santa Fe. And as the obituaries told you and Katie Beth mentioned, he really did write a letter in 1944 when he was 12 about an error that he found on the national spelling test. And he got back two typewritten, hand-signed responses. My grandmother kept them. And the first one says, "Dear Mr. Whitehurst, thank you for your letter of the 14th, calling our attention to an error in the speed test in Gates Reading Survey. You are right. A spider is not an insect. We are writing to the author, and the next printing of the text will be corrected." Then the author, Arthur Gates, wrote Daddy a letter that said, "It is a delight to find school pupils who are so exacting in their use of words. You are really quite right, and you have identified what, strictly speaking, is an error that has not been noticed by anyone else, although many thousands of pupils have all over the United States have taken this test. I am very grateful to you." Only Dad and my daughter Mary Patricia would have written the test people to say there was an error. But from childhood, Daddy just loved learning. He was also fascinated with making things fly. His hero was Claire Chennault, who was a World War I and a World War II ace fighting pilot. So it's no surprise that his grandson Michael is a pilot. Daddy liked to design and build his own ideas from scratch. He'd draw the plans on a piece of paper or on a napkin or paper towel, and then he'd start inventing. And as a child, he filled their yard in Mansfield and their driveway with model planes and gliders, some being life-size. Then he and his friend Jerry Coleman would take them out to the Mansfield High School football field and test them. Dad was valedictorian of his Mansfield High School class. We did not know that until we found the scrapbook my grandmother made. And he edited the national speech that was sent out that all valedictorians were supposed to read. Mary Patricia says he was a pretty good editor. Then he went to LSU. He got on the bus with $100 in his pocket and three suits of khakis, which meant matching khaki shirt and pants. And he rode down the bus where he lived in the stadium for 4 years. Every time I sat by Roy Beard here at the church, he would tell me about Daddy being the cadet colonel of the Pershing Rifles and how important that was. After LSU, Daddy married our mom and moved to Kirtland Air Force Base in Albuquerque, New Mexico, where Tracy and I were born. And after a couple of years there, he moved to Huntsville, Alabama, and worked in the early missile and space program. He always said that those years working in the space program were the most fun times he ever had. And he made lifelong friends there. One of them, Steve Tondera, came over here to Shreveport 20 years later for Daddy's 50th birthday. The best thing about Alabama was that Mary Evelyn was born there. But you can imagine that three girls that probably didn't pay very much attention heard a whole lot about space and rockets and boosters and all that kind of stuff growing up. And if it was on TV, you can better believe we were sitting in front of it and watching it. We didn't always listen, but we had to watch. From NASA, Dad went into computers because he could read machine language, which is the language that makes computers go. And here in Shreveport, he worked at IBM and made lifelong friends like Phil Gill, who's already in heaven, and Heinz Vaughn, and a whole lot of other men. Dad loved solving problems, and he loved making computers do things that he wanted them to do. As early as I can remember, Dad was working all the time, but he was always available to us. He might, as my husband would say, might minimize us on his computer screen, but he was always as close as a phone call or a click. We could hear Dad's whistle all the way across South Highlands when he got home and whistled, which meant it was time to get our skinny selves home. And our cousins, Lee, Wally, and Jeffrey, lived across the street from us in Delaware, on Delaware Street, and they'd hang out on the corner and wait for Dad's car to pull into the driveway. And as soon as he got out of the car, they'd start yelling, "Uncle Gug, can we come over?" Because Dad was always good for a game of catch or a joke or whatever. Dad was a great girl dad. He had high expectations, but he believed in us totally. He expected us to give every job the best we could give, and far beyond whatever that job required. In a time when women's liberation was yet to be, Dad didn't give a rip about gender roles. If we wanted to do something, he said, go for it. And maybe that's the reason that every Whitehurst girl knows how to back up a trailer, how to pilot a boat, how to pack a car trunk, and do all kinds of things like that. Dad is also, Mary Evelyn says, probably the reason why we think it's perfectly normal to have a speeding ticket stuck in the visor of our cars. Dad was too busy doing mental math to worry about his speed. So he never got too upset with us when we got speeding tickets. We didn't tell Mom, we just told Dad. Not only did Dad have high expectations, but Dad was also completely supportive and he had great compassion. Now there's nobody that knows Dad that would describe him as a patient man. But with us, he had extraordinary patience. And we gave him some good testing. I cannot begin to describe all of the times when we called Dad to say, Dad, the car broke down and I've got to go somewhere. Or, Dad, I just hit a parked truck. Or, that was me. Or, Dad, I had a flat tire. That was Mary Evelyn. When Dad arrived, he found out that Mary Evelyn had 4 flat tires and bent rims. When he asked Mary Evelyn, how could you get 4 flat tires at the same time? She said, well, Dad, I hit a median. It's no big deal. It could happen to anyone. Dad was exasperated, but he took care of it. And I can't tell you how many times we just abandoned cars and left Daddy to take care of them. And Daddy had compassion. He could get mad at us, but somehow by the end, if we cried, Daddy ended up hugging us and making us feel better. When any of our lives hit a snag, especially a large one, Daddy was there with his tools, his amazing mind, his giant heart, his faithful prayers, and his willingness to do whatever it took to fix our problem. So it's not hard for us to understand that God is a God of high expectation and high compassion and mercy and love. Like the story of the prodigal son. Dad never stopped trying to take care of us. Just as Katie Beth said, he just kept on protesting if we paid for anything and kept on slipping us money and calling it gas money. He always just said, I'm the dad, I pay. Dad believed in commitment. He was committed to doing anything well, but more than anything, Dad wanted to be ready when he met God. He wanted to live a life of faith so that when he met God, God would say, well done, my good and faithful servant. I gave you a lot of responsibility and you never let me down. Dad had high standards for himself, and we never wanted to let Dad down either. We just didn't want to disappoint him. On April 16, 1988, Dad and Marilyn married, and Dad gained another daughter, Janie, with whom he bonded over dogs immediately, and a son, Huff, with whom he bonded over hunting. Dad and Marilyn embraced all of us, with our children and our grandchildren, and they were always open to our visits, even if we descended on them in hordes. They just laughed and made the best of it, whether it was at Lake Bistineau or absolutely when we just followed them out to Santa Fe. They just welcomed us and said, come on in, and always made sure they had room for all of us. Thank you. Thank you, Marilyn. That was a gift. Dad's core was his faith. As a scientist and an artist, Dad had a deep and abiding sense of God's presence in the world around him and in places that he believed were not yet discovered. 2 years ago, I drove Dad from Santa Fe to Dallas, and he and I talked the whole way about him reminding me that we should never presume that we know anything. He said, we only know a fraction of what is out there and who is out there, because God is God, and we will never comprehend it all. Dad didn't hesitate to get on his knees to pray, and he studied his Bible for his whole life. When I went to seminary, he read every book that I was assigned, and he knew little known and uninteresting facts about the Bible. And here at First Baptist, he did every kind of job, from teaching Sunday school to being chairman of the deacons. He loved his family and faith here, and he did to his dying day. Friends like Cody White and Willis Meadows and Dr. Robert Hendrick and Mrs. Francis Ray and Brother Jim Smith and Mr. Burton Hurd and Mr. Greenlee and Clovis Birch and Harold Bicknell and so many people I cannot name, and y'all are probably already all sitting in here. On Sundays, Daddy loved greeting everybody that came through his door. And he stayed until he was the last person in the sanctuary. So we were always sitting way out there in the parking lot in the car waiting for him. When he came walking jauntily out, and then he would jump up in the air and click his heels together to make us laugh and take us to El Chico's for lunch. Mary Evelyn shares the gift of funny with Dad. She also shares his gift for logic, which she uses in court, and his talent for cooking. But for all of us, it is easy to believe that God has a sense of humor because God created laughter. When Dad married Marilyn, he became a faithful member of St. Mark's Episcopal Church. And when they moved to Santa Fe, he and Marilyn became pillars of Holy Faith Episcopal Church. And he did so many things there that I can barely list them. But I will say one thing he did was play the role of John the Baptist. And that was just a few years ago, and I was there when he did it for the children. And Marilyn would dress him up in all these skins and a rope belt and sandals, and he would pretend, he would run in and act like he was running from Herod. Daddy was pretty funny. As Katie Beth told you, Dad loved life in its full and glorious width and breadth, and he loved people, and he loved ciphering. He got the word from Jethro Bodine on the Beverly Hillbillies. And even in the last 2 weeks, Dad was figuring out how much molding was in the ceiling of his room of the North Tower in the pavilion at the Oaks. I'm really not kidding. Daddy brought it up to Tracy and me. He also had an issue with where the can lights were. When Dad got quiet, we knew he was doing his ciphering. And he wrote equations on pieces of napkin and paper towel all the time. And I have the last equation that he drew for me on a paper towel on my refrigerator right this minute. Dad loved country music, and I thank Gay for playing country music this morning, all his favorite songs before. He loved old TV shows and jokes and making and building and creating anything, and Tracy inherited that. She has her own power saws. She is a chip off the old block. Over 2 summers, Dad built a sailboat. Mike said it would never float, but we ended up sailing on it. It actually worked. Dad loved cooking, and he loved eating, and he talked Shorty Leonard. Remember the chef that was here a long time ago? He talked Shorty Leonard into teaching him how to make Black Forest cake and spent a few days in the kitchen with Shorty Leonard. How Daddy did that, we will never know, but he did it. He and Marilyn loved their dogs that were like more children. There was Otto and Caesar and Hannibal and more recently Bentley and Emmett and Maggie T, who is actually Margaret Thatcher. And Daddy wanted to talk about anything and everything except clothes and girl stuff. So he was so glad when Tracy and I got married and Glen and Mike came into the family and the dinner conversations changed. Daddy loved crossword puzzles and he loved his Friday competitions with Uncle Charles. Ben's here. Uncle Charles' son, my cousin. he and Uncle Charles had a Wall Street Journal Friday crossword puzzle contest. And 1 week they would just do the horizontals. And 1 week they would just do the verticals. And they just made up rules and challenged each other. And then he had a Friday lunch date with Tracy, crossword puzzle and Sudoku contest. Most of all, Dad loved his grandchildren. And I thank every one of you for all of the things that you did for Dad in his life. Y'all were each so special to him in your own way. And you did so much for him. And he did so much for you. And thank you, Janie and Huff, for being his children as well. He loved you like he loved us. To him, we were all one big happy family. Is it any wonder that we understand God as a father who welcomes and loves and demands and forgives and embraces? Daddy lived his life right up until the very end, even when he couldn't move. He tried to be a good sport about it, even when he really didn't like what was going on. He laughed and joked with the nurses and told them about making gumbo. And he endured it by his strong faith, by his absolute deep adoration of Marilyn and his love for all of us. And Marilyn, I'm looking at you and saying thank you. Thank you for allowing Tracy and Mary Ellen and me to walk through the valley of the shadow of death with Daddy. We will never be able to thank you enough for that. It's a gift that you gave us. Daddy really was a living parable in our lives. He lived complete trust in God. And we all know that Dad is in the full love and light that is God's presence. Our Father is with the Father now. And we all have faith that Dad heard those words, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." Tracy says after that, Papa already grabbed him and said, "I've been waiting for you. I got the tools. Bob's up to speed. We got a lot of projects. Let's get going." And we think probably there's a bushel of oysters in a big old tub, and they've gotten out their pocket knives, and they have a sleeve of saltines, and they're busy eating oysters and doing projects. On Sunday, I got to spend a lot of time with him in the afternoon. I was saying the 23rd Psalm to him about walking through the valley of the shadow of death, and we were talking about what was out there in the light, Mimi and Papaw and Bob. And Daddy said Bob's name 2 times with a big old smile on his face, like he could really see Bob. And I must have sung, I think I sang "On Jordan's Stormy Banks" at least 4 times. And then he did this with his hand, like, keep on singing it. I had to change hymns. I was just Jordaned out. But we know that Daddy's with God, and God is with us. So, Dad, we love you, and we are so thankful that we got to be your daughters and your son and your granddaughters and your grandsons and your nieces and nephews and friends. We're going to miss you like crazy, but you're forever in our hearts. Well done, Dad. Well done.
Clista and Katie Beth, thank you so much for sharing and honoring Doug in sharing his life today. As I sat with the family yesterday and in listening today and reading the wonderful obituary, it's just struck by his faithfulness. The Bible tells us, to whom much is given, much is required. And so much was given to Doug, and he has just proven faithful in his work and in his academics and his art and his family and all of it. And today, just as he has loved you so well and cared for you, you have cared for him very well and loved him. And so this is a day of celebration for us. Thank you so much for being here today, and your presence means so much to this family. In just a moment, we're going to pray, and I'll lead the family out these doors and down the hall to the parlor, and they would love for you to come and visit with them there. Let's pray together. Father, as we commit Doug Whitehurst completely into your hands, we do so in faith, and we do so in hope, and Lord, we trust in your promises today. And we know that you are giving Doug a new body, a heavenly body. And Lord, we all look forward to that time when we will no longer experience pain and the brokenness and suffering of this fallen world, but we trust in you. And God, we know that you are a mighty God who is making all things new. In your name we pray. Amen.